As a kid, I grew up watching a lot of reruns of old Hanna Barbera cartoons, usually on the USA Cartoon Express, Cartoon Network, or some weird local channel we had in Ardmore, Oklahoma. So I've grown quite fond of this animation studio and still love a majority of their output to this very day. Now, I'm not saying everything they make is good, because they definitely made a lot of bad stuff, especially during the 80s. But considering how prolific they were and the cheap budget they had to work with, I'd say they produced more hits than misses. So with that said, I want to show my love for Hanna-Barbera by doing a list of what I feel are the top 7 best Hanna-Barbera cartoons. But just remember, this is just my personal opinion on display here, and nothing to get upset over. Bam! Number 7.
This here modern superhero, who's the most clever crime fighter of them all, namely, Hong Kong Fooey.
Fan-rific. Taking a shot from the both growing popularity of Hong Kong martial arts movies and crime-fighting cartoons popular in the 70s, we get Hong Kong Fooey. In this show, the clumsy janitor to the local police office, named Penry, fights crime under the alias of Hong Kong Fooey, the equally clumsy and inept martial artist crime fighter voiced by the always talented Scatman Crothers. In a lot of ways, Hong Kong Fooey is kind of like a predecessor to later cartoons like Inspector Gadget and Darkwing Duck, in the fact that it stars a hero who's just as egotistical as he is inept at his job, often succeeding at capturing the bad guys either by complete dumb luck or the help of his sidekick, the faithful police cat Spot, voiced by my personal favorite voice actor, Don Messick. This is played up further with the gag that Fooey often has to resort to his Hong Kong Book of Kung Fu on what to do, since he never seemed to have memorized any of his martial arts moves in the first place. That, and the moves he uses, often don't really work.
Well, I can do that.
So can I, boss. Look! Yah! Ha! Yow! See ya! Yo! See ya!
Oh, come on, fellas.
Those guys must have taken the same course I did.
Also, I don't know if it's his absent-mindedness, delusions of grandeur, half-lit expression, relaxed attitude, or Scatman Crothers' voice, but I always get this sneaking suspicion that Hong Kong Fooey is smoking the Hong Kong doobie. Regardless of his ego, he is generally a nice guy.
But my keen ear sight tells me that cute little gal is mighty unhappy about something. Why all the howling, cute little girl?
Why, it must have been the gumdrop kid. Quick, which way did he go?
He went that way.
Here's another lollipop for you, cute little girl. It was once owned by Hong Kong Fooey himself.
Oh, wow! The great Hong Kong Fooey! I'm never gonna eat this!
In that case, I'll buy it back. Lemon lime's my favorite flavor. Sayonara!
Well, most of the time.
And now we're gonna get the bird. Somehow that doesn't sound right.
And seemingly got a dirty joke past the overbearing 70s censors. Regardless, I love this show and its martial arts nonsense. So while the theme song may claim that he's the number one super guy, he ranks number 7 among all his Hanna-Barbera brethren. Bam! Number 6.
Stretch. It's those wacky racers who forced me to be a bad guy. Just look at what they're making me do. Use this squadron of remote-controlled mechanical mosquitoes. I don't want to do it, honestly. But, go get them, you mindless meanies!
God, I love this man. Ah, Wacky Races, one of the only Hanna-Barbera cartoons Warner seems to acknowledge the existence of, other than Scooby-Doo. Well, at least Mexico acknowledges Top Cat, but that's beside the point. Taking inspiration from the movie The Great Race, Wacky Races is a cartoon about a group of 11 racers racing to victory. This includes such fun and creative racers as Penelope Pitstop, Peter Perfect, the Ant Hill Mob, Professor Pat Pending, and more. But let's not lie to ourselves. The real reason you watch this show is for the villains Dick Dastardly and Muttley, who are honestly the true main characters of the show. See, every episode revolves around Dick Dastardly, a literal mustache-twirling villain, using his car's great speed to get ahead of the other cars, and then try to set up traps to help him keep the lead. Yes, Dick Dastardly has such a heavy cartoon villain condition that even when he's got a great lead, he has to stop what he's doing to try and cheat and keep his victory. I mean, he's a villain. It's what he does.
Right! I'm going to win this race fair and square, even if I have to cheat to do it!
Unfortunately, being a great cartoon villain has its negatives, namely that all of Dastardly's plans oftentimes blow up in his face. Oftentimes literally.
Now! Now what went wrong?
To assist Dastardly is his sidekick, the wheezy and sleazy Muttley, played by the always awesome Don Messick. Muttley assists Dastardly in all of his plans, sometimes begrudgingly, but oftentimes just to get joy out of watching Dastardly fail.
What happened, Dick?
We got lost.
With a combination bloodhound, pointer, and hunting dog? How could you get lost?
Ask him!
And seemingly, Muttley wasn't the only person who liked watching Dick fail, because the characters were so popular that Hanna Barbera spun them off into their own show called Dastardly and Muttley and Their Flying Machines. However, Dastardly and Muttley weren't the only ones to get the spin-off treatment. The adorable Southern belle Penelope Pitstop also got her own spin-off with The Perils of Penelope's Pitstop, which also includes another one of the racers, the Ant Hill Mob. And while both spin-offs are fun shows, neither of them match up to the simple fun of the original series. So what more can I say other than Wacky Races is just a real fun ride? Bam! Number 5.
Here we go again!
You're going right into them!
That's the general idea!
Huh?
Fasten your seatbelt!
The animation might be limited and crude, but heck, Johnny Quest is still one of the most action-packed cartoons ever to air on television. When I was a child and I watched this for the first time, I was hooked as soon as the intro music started. The trombones and the drums mixed with all the crazy monsters and action imagery just told me that I was going to get a cartoon experience like none other I've ever seen, and boy was I right. Despite some 60s-era B-movie logic, this show takes itself way more seriously than most cartoons, especially those that came from Hanna-Barbera, but still manages to make an entertaining and surprisingly violent show. Seriously, people die on this show. It like blew my little kid mind when I first saw that. But this doesn't mean the show doesn't have its comic relief moments.
Look, Bandit, be reasonable. You have to go in the valise.
Wait, Johnny. Perhaps I can be of help. Sim, sim, salabim. Our problem is gone.
Gosh, Haji, that was great. How'd you do it?
I cannot tell you, Johnny. It is an old trick that has been in our family for years.
Oh yeah, and some well-intended casual racism, too. The show's cast of characters include Johnny Quest, an 11-year-old boy who is often brought on amazing adventures with his scientist father, Dr. Benton Quest. Also along for the ride is the family bodyguard, secret agent, and regular badass, Race Bannon, as well as Johnny's adopted brother and Indian mystic, Haji, and the Quest family dog, Bandit. Both Dr. Quest and Bandit's voices are provided by the previously mentioned favorite voice actor of mine, Don Messick. The adventures of the Quest family range anywhere from spy espionage to giant monsters, and special props to the episode with the invisible monster.
No! No! Come back!
Oh no! He got attacked by the Photoshop inverse filter! Ah! Considering the low budget of this cartoon, they could have easily gotten away with animating absolutely nothing for that monster. But despite that, they still found ways to animate it, either by having it leave steaming footprints in the ground, or blowing random shit up, which is a surprising amount of effort for a show this old. That episode also managed to pull off a lot of suspense, and when you did get to see the monster, it looked pretty horrifying for a cartoon show. I mean, jeez and crow, it looks like a horror movie rendition of one of the Pac-Man ghosts. And random note, Don Messick and Race's voice actor Mike Rode played their parody counterparts in Freakazoid's Johnny Quest parody, Toby Danger.
What if they can't stop it, Doctor?
Then we'll use my parapower ray gun.
But you don't even know if it works. You haven't tested it yet.
We don't have a choice. We have to test it now.
Can nothing stop this thing?
Just let me throw a barrel at it.
Dash! No!
Regardless, Johnny Quest was Hanna-Barbera's first and best action-adventure cartoon. Many followed this one, some of which were attempts to revive Johnny Quest itself, but none I felt ever managed to capture the intensity and fun of the original. Like I said from the start, Johnny Quest is one of the best action cartoons ever made, and if you haven't seen it, I highly recommend checking it out. Bam! Number 4.
We're gonna have to figure out a story to tell our wives, Barney.
Oh, I have my story all set.
Yeah? What is it?
Well, I'll walk into the house, right up to Betty, and I'll say, Betty, Fred Flintstone made me quit my job today.
And then what?
I kill myself. What else?
Well, I guess sometimes you just gotta yabba-dabba do it. What can I say? It's practically impossible to make a list of best Hanna-Barbera cartoons and not have everyone's favorite Stone Age family mentioned on it. The Flintstones take some heavy inspiration from the TV show The Honeymooners, but set it in the Stone Age, well, a Stone Age that attempts at being 1960s America, that is, which is actually one of the most creative and fun parts of the show, is seeing how the show uses various animals to give characters on the show all this comforts that they would have at, well, at the time, modern living, as well as this long-running gag.
It's a living.
It's a living.
It's a living.
Hey, that last one's not an animal. At least, I don't think so. In this Stone Age world, we focus on the friendship of two families, the Flintstones and the Rubbles. In the first few seasons, the Flintstone family consists of Boris, short-tempered jerk with a heart of gold, Fred Flintstone. And hey, it's worth mentioning that despite his loud yelling, Fred has never threatened to beat Wilma, unlike his honeymooner's counterpart.
One of these days, Alice, bang, zoom, straight to the moon.
That's not an astronaut, it's a TV comedian. And he was just using space travel as a metaphor for beating his wife.
Wilma is Fred's more intelligent, level-headed, but sometimes nagging wife. As is the standard of most 60s families, she does the housewife chores of cooking and cleaning while Fred works a job.
They sure work hard, don't they, Barney?
Yeah, I hate to see them work so hard.
Yeah, me too.
Let's go around back where we can't see
him. Jeez, what a jerk. Wilma and Fred argue and fight a lot, but it seems obvious that they indeed love each other, even if there is a few episodes that actually delves into the rockiness of their marriage. Along for the ride are the Flintstones' neighbors and best friends, the Rubbles. Barney Rubble is Fred's best friend and confidant, even if Barney often gets the brunt of Fred's ill temper. Barney is kind and friendly, but also kind of dopey and smart-alecky. Barney is also voiced by the legendary voice actor Mel Blanc, best known as being the original voice for a majority of the Looney Tunes cast. Betty is Barney's wife, and she's nice and fun-loving and loves Barney dearly. In fact, their relationship is outright adorable at times.
Oh, dear. Barney, the garbage disposal isn't working.
Oh, well, let me show you how to fix it. All you gotta do is press this red button, like this.
Oh, Barney, you can fix anything.
And I'll take the usual payment. Thank you.
Wholesome. Absolutely wholesome. As the series goes along, pets and children get added to the series. The Flintstones get a pet dinosaur that acts like a modern-day dog named Dino, also voiced by Blank. And after the Flintstones have a daughter named Pebbles. Pebbles? What a fruity name. The Rubbles will adopt a son named Bam Bam, voiced by Hanna-Barbera go-to voice actor Don Messick. And the Rubbles will also get a pet prehistoric kangaroo named Hoppy, also voiced by Messick. I actually find this aspect really interesting, because despite how cartoony the Flintstones is, this actually kind of makes them a little more realistic in the fact that the family dynamic actually changes as the show goes on, in comparison to something like, I don't know, The Simpsons or Family Guy, where the family dynamic stays the exact same throughout the entire run of the series. Another interesting note about this show is it's often seen now as a kid's cartoon, though that wasn't originally the case. See, The Flintstones was the first cartoon that was made specifically for primetime television, as it's literally an animated sitcom. In fact, shows like The Simpsons and Family Guy may have never existed if it wasn't for The Flintstones. With that said, The Flintstones do reference adult things, and even have a few naughty jokes here and there, like this one.
Here we are, Barney Boy, costumers. What kind of costume you gonna get?
Well, I'm gonna get something that makes me look tall.
How about another head?
Another one? What do I need three of them for?
Yeah, you heard right. Barney just made a dick joke. And that doesn't even get into the fact that the Flintstones were often used to advertise things like cigarettes and beer. Which, considering how people view these characters now, that seems really odd by today's standards.
Boy, this bush does it.
You can't say beer better, Fred.
But we have more cartoons to discuss on this list, so time to move on. Just remember, when you watch the Flintstones, you'll have a yabba-dabba-doo time, a dabba-doo time, you'll have a gay old time. Wait. Bam! Number 3.
Exactly the cruise I had in mind, and the accommodations aren't what you'd call first class, but who's complaining? At least this way, I'll avoid the crowds. Nothing.
Inspired by the Phil Silver Show, Top Cat is the story of Top Cat, or TC as his friends call him, and his gang of alley cats who try to swindle people out of money and avoid the watchful eye of beat cop Officer Dibble. Like the Flintstones, Top Cat was originally created and aired as an animated primetime sitcom, and thus the show focused more on dialogue-based humor than many of Hanna-Barbera's other shows.
How do you feel, TC?
Terrible. I don't know if I've been rubbed down or rubbed out.
Top Cat, being the sly, fast-talking leader of the group, is always talking his way out of trouble, as well as thinking of ways to con people out of money or get himself some free food. Top Cat's gang includes his innocent and naive right-hand man, Benny the Ball, the enthusiastic and sometimes memed Choo Choo, Lay's man Fancy Fancy, Beatnik Spook, and the ironically named Brain. And always a thorn in their side is the aforementioned beat cop Officer Dibble, always trying to find a reason to run Top Cat in. Fortunately, Top Cat is usually able to talk his way out of these situations.
Caught you red-handed using the police phone and interfering with official business, didn't I? You'll get 30 days for this.
Just a minute, Officer Dibble. Let me hear that voice again. Surely you must have sung at the Met at one time.
Well,
Come, don't be modest, sir. Let me hear that golden voice once more, that deplorable baritone.
All right.
Oh, wandering minstrel alive, a thing of shreds.
Wonderful, wonderful. Ugh. What range, what power. Now let's hear it from back further.
Okay, I'll go down to the end of the alley.
That's it, Dibble. Go way back so I can fully appreciate those bear-shaped tonsils.
How's this?
Fine, fine. So long, Dibble.
So long, Top Cat. Thanks.
Now, wait a minute.
I'll be doggone if he didn't do it again. I had him and he slipped right out of my hands.
Though, to his credit, Dibble gets a few great lines in from time to time.
Did Benny the Ball say he was going to Hawaii?
He said something about the islands. Of course, if he keeps hanging around with you, he'll end up on an island, all right. Alcatraz.
Alcatraz? Funny, very funny, Alcatraz. Nothing.
The fun of the show is seeing the crazy situations TC and his crew get into, and then seeing how they manage to get out of them with their cunning wit. It's definitely by far one of the more clever Hanna-Barbera shows, though it still manages to get a few slapstick moments in to keep the kids interested. So I definitely stand Top Cat as my third to favorite Hanna-Barbera cartoon, because to me, it's the cat's meow.
So long, Jazz. If you don't get a letter, you'll know we didn't write.
Wait. This is the only Hanna-Barbera cartoon in this list not to have Don Messick mentioned as a voice actor in the show. That can't be right. Don Messick's in, like, almost everything Hanna-Barbera does. He's gotta be in there somewhere. Oh, there was that dog Griswold that appeared in a few episodes. Okay, there he is. Whew! Worried for a second.
All right, let's get it over with.
Whoa! Where the hell did he just bite TC? I mean, it can't be his rear because we can still see his tail. Oh no, I think TC just got neutered the bad way. Bam! Number two.
Well, think no further. Alexander the Great has the most stupendous super colossal plan this side of Corny Island.
Oh, that's a wonderful plan, Alexander.
I haven't told you what it is yet. Alan, you take Josie, Melody, and Alexandra and sneak into the storage room and grab the instruments. Now, while that's going on, Valerie very cleverly gets aboard the sub and discombobulates the engine. It'll be a cinch.
Wait a minute. You left out one small detail.
What's that?
Just what are you going to do?
Who, me? I'm gonna stay here and hide. What else? Help! Let go! There's got to be a law against this!
Yeah, Josie and the Pussycats might be the first of the Scooby-Doo clones, but I can't help but love this show. As quoted in my Fang Face review, it's like Scooby-Doo, except Scooby's a bitch. Okay, enough kidding. Because despite it being branded as a Scooby clone, it's actually quite a bit different. Loosely based on an Archie comic of the same name, Josie and the Pussycats is about a world-traveling group of teenagers in a pop-rock band named, well, Josie and the Pussycats. Thanks to them dressing in skin-tight cat outfits when they play. No wonder Teenage Pimmy stayed up so late to watch this on Cartoon Network. The band consists of level-headed Josie, mechanical genius Valerie, and ditzy blonde Melody. Also with them is muscular team lead Rhodey Allen, cowardly manager Alexander, his bitchy conniving sister Alexandra, and her cat Sebastian, who's voiced by Don Messick. However, unlike the Scooby cast, Josie and friends don't solve mysteries. They instead keep getting mixed up in the evil plots of a variety of rejected Johnny Quest villains. With the group usually stumbling upon the latest villain of the day's plot and having to find out a way to foil them. With many of the episodes even coming up with excuses of why they can't just go to the authorities and have them resolve the issue instead.
Hey, I got a plan too. Let's take this mission to the police.
Don't you remember what the voice said?
Yeah, we go to the police and...
Oh, you would have to remind me.
Zoinks, this Alexander guy sounds awfully familiar. Regardless, this show has the characters traveling all over the world, playing music, and going up against mad scientists with evil plant monsters, the Invisible Man, and a variety of international spies in an action-packed comedy cartoon that's an absolute joy to watch. And has to be one of my favorite Hanna-Barbera cartoons. Only topped by one. Wonder what it could be. Bam! Number one.
Quick, Scooby, put this key in a safe place.
Right.
Oh no, another door. Old frightening face won't be able to open the door now. Oh no, it opened the other way. Quick, Scoob, give me the key. You threw it out the window. We gotta get that key and get out of here.
Where is it?
Got it. Now we can get out of here.
Let's be honest, if you didn't see this coming as number one, then I can only assume you've never heard of Hanna-Barbera before. Because my favorite Hanna-Barbera cartoon isn't just Scooby-Doo, but it's Scooby's first and original series, Scooby-Doo, Where Are You? For those who somehow haven't heard of Scooby-Doo, no, I fail to believe that no one has ever heard of everyone's favorite Great Dane. But regardless, I'll give you a quick synopsis anyways. Scooby-Doo Where Are You is about a gang of teenagers who band together to solve mysteries, which always seems to be tied to some supernatural being, but in the end of the episode, the supernatural being is always revealed to be a hoax by some sort of crook or con artist. Well, most of the time anyways. There are exceptions. Like that episode with Charlie the Robot. It was just the robot causing the madness and someone mishandling his controls, but most of the time it's a guy in a suit. The group consists of strong-willed leader of the gang, Freddy Jones, which happens to be the first role of the world's most prolific voice actor, Frank Welker, a character he still voices to this very day. So for those who aren't keeping track, that's 50 years he's managed to play the exact same character. The rest of the characters being danger-prone Daphne, intelligent and analytical Velma Dinkley, cowardly but always hungry Shaggy Rogers, and his equally cowardly and hungry Great Dane, Scooby-Doo, which is by far Don Messick's most well-known role. Interesting fact about this show is originally it was going to focus more on horror mystery elements and go under the name of Who's Scared, but the censors refused that idea, thinking it would be too scary for children. You gotta keep in mind, this is during a time when censors were really cracking down on cartoon shows and what they considered acceptable for children's television. So what the show did was amp up the comedy aspects of the show and shifting the focus from Fred and the girls to Shaggy and Scooby, so the show would be considered more suitable for children. And while the comedy aspect is far more the focus, one of the main reasons I like Where Are You in comparison to a lot of the other Scooby shows Hanna Barbera did is a lot of the more horror spooky elements of the original idea still can be seen in this show. It uses a darker color palette than most of the other Hanna Barbera cartoons do, which I feel really helps the show have a spooky atmosphere to it. And there's definitely some slight dark elements in the show, which, while always proven to be hoaxes, scenes that are made to look like dead bodies in a coffin or a decapitated head, is still somewhat dark for a cartoon at this time. Hell, it even manages to have a few slightly unsettling scenes.
Mr. Dorman, wake up! Wake up! Come on, wake up!
He's a puppet too!
And I won't lie, the space kook gave me nightmares when I was a kid. I mean, look at this fucking guy. I also felt that Where Are You struck this perfect balance of sometimes realism with absurd cartoonishness. Sure, there's some pretty goofy nonsense moments.
Whoa! He's gonna build up speed and ram the door with a block of ice! Go, Scooby-Doo! Look out, Scoob!
Oh no, he's losing control!
Hit the keyhole so hard it was forced through in the shape of a key.
But regardless, I think it manages to get a good balance overall. Though I kind of feel like with each sequel series made after Where Are You, the colors got brighter, the antics got more cartoonish, and everything just got safer and safer and made it less and less threatening. Where Are You is like that perfect blend for me. It's really comedic, but still gives us just enough mystery and spookiness to keep everything fun and interesting. Best of all, the characters are also fun and likable. Sure, they might not be the most fleshed out characters, but they're all still enjoyable to see interact and react with the situations given to them. And one thing to note is while yes, the show repeats animation like nobody's business, I do like that all the characters are at least given their own specific run and walk cycles. So while the animation is repeated a lot, the repeated animation also adds personality to the characters since the animation was made specifically for them, like Shaggy's loose, lazy, floppy walk or Velma's choo-choo train run. It gives them so much more character in comparison to some shows that would just apply the same walk and run cycles to every character. Also, as I've mentioned in some of the other reviews I've done, Scooby-Doo is just one of those shows that just has a special place in my heart, as it's always been there for me throughout my entire childhood and adulthood. So yeah, Scooby-Doo, Where Are You is my absolute favorite Hanna-Barbera cartoon. But hey, these are just my personal favorites. But the question is, what are your personal favorites? Feel free to post them in the comments below. I'd love to hear about them. Now, how should I end this video, though? With a yabba-dabba-doo? Or a Scooby-Dooby-Doo? Or a snickering laugh? I don't know. But if you want me to do more top 7s like this, I'd appreciate it if you would Scooby-Doo me a favor and click that like button to inspire more of these. And see ya!